Good morning, everyone. If you're able to, please stand for the arrival of Her Excellency the Honourable Miss Anne Mostyn, AC, Governor-General of the Commonwealth of Australia, and His Excellency Mr Simeon Beckett, SC, and the Minister for Foreign Affairs, Senator the Honourable Penny Wong. Thank you. You may now take your seats. On behalf of the host of the MH17 10-year commemoration, the Minister for Foreign Affairs, Senator the Honourable Penny Wong, I would like to welcome everyone here today. My name's Mary Geeran. I was ABC Europe correspondent in July 2014, sent to report from Schiphol Airport, a place hundreds of strangers were drawn to lay flowers and offer condolences in the face of unimaginable tragedy. It is my great privilege to be here with you today on this solemn occasion to remember and honour the lives lost in the downing of Malaysia Airlines flight MH17, particularly those who called Australia home. This service is a time for us to reflect on their lives and honour their memory. It is for you, their families and their loved ones. We hope you can find some comfort here today in being here together in the Great Hall of Parliament House, where many of you gathered 1 year after the downing on 17th of July 2015. To those of you who've travelled from near or far, thank you. We are honoured to be joined today by dignitaries, the Governor-General, Her Excellency the Honourable Sam Mostyn AC, who will deliver opening remarks, Excellencies, representatives of the Diplomatic Corps, we thank you for joining us. And to those nations who also lost lives in the downing, our thoughts are with you on this day. Former Prime Minister, the Honourable Tony Abbott, AC. Chief of the Defence Force, Admiral David Johnston, ACRAN. Members and Senators, Secretaries of Departments. We also welcome our speakers here today, former Foreign Minister, the Honourable Julie Bishop, and Australian Federal Police Commissioner, Rhys Kershaw, APM, who will both be delivering remarks. We're also joined by government officials, including the Family Investigative Liaison Officers, who've provided support for families and loved ones over the past 10 years, as well as those involved in the response and investigation into the downing, and those who are involved in the ongoing quest for justice. Please be advised that this event is being live streamed and will be recorded for those who haven't been able to attend. I would now like to invite Selena Walker to welcome us to country. Ms Walker is a respected Ngunnawal leader and emerging elder whose achievements have also been recognised through her nomination as 2024 ACT Local Hero. Thank you, Ms Walker.
Thank you. Yuma. Galaganya Jelena Walker. Darawa Nuna Darawa Ngunnawal. Hello, my name is Selena Walker and this is Ngunnawal Country. I'd like to first start by acknowledging my elders, the Ngunnawal elders, and pay respect to my elders past, present and future. I'd also like to acknowledge the recent passing of my grandmother, Aunty Agnes Shea, who was the most senior Ngunnawal elder here. I want to acknowledge any other Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people that are with us here, welcome my brothers, sisters, aunts and uncles, and extend that to all of our non-Indigenous friends that have joined us. Ladies, gentlemen and distinguished guests, welcome. The Ngunnawal community are the traditional custodians of Canberra and the region. You may not be aware that the Ngunnawal Nation is made up of several family groups and not just individuals who represent this country. Therefore, as a community, we have an elected body known as the United Ngunnawal Elders Council to represent us, along with the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander elected body of the ACT. It is important for you to understand and acknowledge, for our identity is a collective identity. There are other Indigenous and non-Indigenous people from around the nation, the country and the world who have come to live on Ngunnawal land. I'd like to acknowledge and welcome you all. The tradition of welcoming the people to country is a practice that was handed down by our ancestors, old people and elders from the beginning of time. Before entering another person's country, you would first announce your arrival and not enter until the traditional owner formally welcomed you. The reason for this practice was to protect your spirit whilst in another person's country and also to show respect for the country which you were entering. It's wonderful to see this practice is now recognised and respected. I suppose it's not like entering into someone's home unless you're first invited. The Ngunnawal people, as within all Aboriginal people, have a great heritage that we would like to share with all Australians from every walk of life. As you are aware, Canberra means meeting place, and Canberra has been a place of gathering for many Aboriginal tribes of Australia to come together to deal with important business and also for ceremonial purposes. Our Ngunnawal ancestors believe in the importance of people gathering to build relationships, share knowledge and to celebrate the gift of heritage and history. We believe it's important for all to recognise our unique history and to gain understanding that our land is our heritage and how loss of the lands has disconnected so many Aboriginal people from their spiritual links, cultural heritage and identity. Reconciliation is not just a word, it's an action, and it's a human rights movement. So, in the spirit of reconciliation, it gives me great pleasure on behalf of the Ngunnawal people on this very sad occasion to welcome you to country. I'll finish in the words of my people, but I first would like to extend my sympathies and heartfelt condolences to the families of this tragedy. So, on behalf of my people, Yumalandi Yunanga Yerebu Yangu, which means you may leave footprints on our land now, or in other words, welcome to country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Walker, for your welcome to country. Guests, if you are able, please be upstanding for the national anthem performed by the ANU Choir. Please be seated. Thank you to the ANU Choir. I would now like to invite the Governor-General of Australia, Her Excellency the Honourable Sam Austin AC, to speak.
Good morning, everybody. I acknowledge that this morning we gather on the lands of the traditional custodians, the Ngunnawal, and recognise any people or families with connections to the lands of the ACT and surrounding regions. I pay my respects to their elders, past and present. And a very special thanks to Selena Walker, Ngunnawal Elder, for your very warm welcome to country. Representatives of the Diplomatic Corps, Senator the Honourable Penny Wong, the Honourable Tony Abbott AC, former Prime Minister of Australia, the Honourable Julie Bishop, former Minister for Foreign Affairs, Admiral David Johnston AC, RAN, and members of the Australian Defence Force, Commissioner Rhys Kershaw, APM, Commissioner of the Australian Federal Police, and members of the Australian Federal Police, members and senators, officials and staff involved in the response to MH17, and most importantly, families and friends of loved ones lost. 298 lives were lost on 17 July 2014, citizens of countries the world over. I acknowledge the representatives from many grieving nations who join us here today. Together, we commemorate our shared sense of loss for every person who died that day. Thank you, Mary, for welcoming us today. Your candour and insight while reporting on the downing of Malaysian airline MH17 was deeply appreciated by those affected and by every Australian watching in disbelief as the magnitude of the tragedy became apparent. I pay tribute to the Australian police, military, diplomatic and consular personnel who worked so hard then and in the months and years afterwards to support grieving families all over Australia. Your actions testify to the healing power of courage, of care, and of compassion. It is right that this memorial is located here at Australia's Parliament House. This house belongs to all Australians. It represents the strength of our democracy and our stewardship of the peace and stability of our nation. It is a place owned by all Australians, where all are always welcome to observe our democracy in action, to celebrate, remember, mourn, and today commemorate. To the families and loved ones of victims, here in this people's place, your fellow Australians remember and honour the precious ones lost to you now 10 years ago. Those men, women, and children are part of you. Each one was cherished for the indelible qualities that define their essence. Some were described as like this, a force to be reckoned with, one of those blithe, gentle spirits, the quintessential quiet achiever, the most amazing person. That they died so far away from home is a profound grief, and without them here, all that is left is to find ways to reflect and to remember. In the aftermath, your acts of care and commemoration have been as different as the dear ones you lost. An art centre was established in Perth, inspired by the energy of three darling children. In Melbourne, rival suburban footy teams competed fiercely for a cup named in honour of two passionate supporters. A smoking ceremony in Arnhem Land united those mourning a treasured young teacher. In homes, family gatherings are illuminated by candles lit in memory of beloved parents, siblings, and children. Here in Canberra, we come together for another ceremony of respect, foreshadowed by former Governor-General Sir Peter Cosgrove in 2014, with his promise that we will never forget the men, women, and children on board that fateful flight. The pain and trauma is yours to carry. We cannot lift it from your hearts, but we are here today to pay tribute, to offer our compassion and our care. The poet Mark Trendinnick writes that grief lasts as long as love was deep. The depth of your love binds you forever to those you lost. Their deaths are your heartache and our nation's sorrow. Today's commemoration is our promise that even with the passing of time, Australia will not forget you, and certainly not those you love and mourn who are forever in our hearts. May they rest in peace.
Thank you, Your Excellency, for your heartfelt words. I would now like to invite today's host, the Minister for Foreign Affairs, Senator the Honourable Penny Wong, to speak.
First, start by paying my respects to the Ngunnawal people. Thank you for the welcome to country. I acknowledge them as the traditional custodians of this land and pay my respects to Elders past and present. I acknowledge the Governor-General, Her Excellency the Honourable Sam Mostyn AC. I acknowledge representatives of the Diplomatic Corps. I acknowledge former Prime Minister Tony Abbott AC. Thank you for being with us. Former Foreign Minister, the Honourable Julie Bishop. Thank you, Julie. To Chief of Defence Force, Admiral David Johnston, AC, RAN. My ministerial and parliamentary colleagues, including the Assistant Foreign Minister, Tim Watts, and the Shadow Foreign Minister, Simon Birmingham. Commissioner, AFP Commissioner Rhys Kershaw. Department Secretaries, members and senators, but most of all, and most importantly, I acknowledge and I welcome the families and the loved ones of victims who are here today. Today in this ceremony, may you know the sympathy and kindness of the nation. As you know, there are also those who are joining the Attorney General at the memorial in the Netherlands, organised by the MH17 Air Disaster Foundation Kin. Well, 10 years ago, we woke to news as incomprehensible now as it was then, 298 lives taken. 298 voyages ended, yet forever incomplete. 38 who called Australia home, one of the worst peacetime losses of Australian life. And for you and so many others, the flight code MH17, serving as an impersonal signifier of the most personal loss, of the sudden violence of that day, of the cheating of innocence. Children travelling across continents and oceans to be home in time for a new school term. Futures promise broken. Families returning from a European summer holiday, years in the dreaming, giddy with stories that would never mellow into memories. Mothers, fathers, grandparents, pillars of communities, lives of service cut short, each a singular tragedy and an infinite loss. Each person with more to give, more to feel, more to do. Each person with a whole world that revolved around them and all those worlds suddenly needing to find a way to keep turning without their axis. So I say to you today, you have lost so much. But you are not alone in your loss. We are with you. And your grief steels us in the fight for justice, as it has steeled Australia since that terrible day, as it steeled our diplomats led by Julie Bishop to achieve what at first seemed impossible, a unanimous UN Security Council resolution condemning the attack, and that gave international backing for an independent investigation carried without Russian veto. And your grief has stilled the hundreds of Australian Federal Police, Defence Force and Australian Transport Safety Bureau personnel whose thorough and painstaking work supported that independent investigation through the MH17 Joint Investigation Team. And together these efforts, on behalf of those we lost and on your behalf and on behalf of the country, have seen charges laid and convictions secured against perpetrators. Sentences of life imprisonment levied against Igor Girkin, Sergei Dubinsky, Leonid Karchenko in 2022 for their involvement in the downing of MH17. And your country has imposed sanctions against these three, as well as Sergei Muchkayev, who commanded the Russian brigade that provided the missile that shot down this plane. The findings of this same court unequivocally and conclusively established Russia's responsibility for the downing of MH17. So while we are appalled that Russia has withdrawn from the action Australia and the Netherlands initiated in the International Civil Aviation Organisation, the case will continue. And we will not be deterred in our commitment to hold Russia to account. We can but imagine the courage you have needed to summon to get through these 10 years. Grief never fully leaves us, but time and love can lessen its weight. Please know that the people you love, the people taken from you, remain in our hearts and in our purpose. And today, on behalf of the Australian Government, I recommit again to our collective pursuit of truth, justice and accountability for the outrages perpetrated on the 17th of July 2014. I recommit to our ongoing partnership with the Netherlands, which lost nearly 200 nationals, with Malaysia, Belgium and Ukraine. And today, we stand with you in your grief. And we say to you, it is not your sorrow to bear alone. We stand with you, and we will not forget those we lost on MH17.
Thank you, Minister Wong, for your profound remarks and for hosting today's service and morning tea. I would now like to pause proceedings for a minute's silence to reflect on the lives and memories of those we lost in the Downing. Following the minute's silence, the ANU Choir will perform Songbird by Fleetwood Mac.
the songbirds keep singing like they
to the ANU choir for, I'm sure we all agree, is such a beautiful and moving performance. I would now like to welcome former Foreign Minister, the Honourable Julie Bishop, to give her personal reflections from the time.
May I add my thanks to the Australian National University Choir. I'm very proud of them. Your Excellency, the Governor General, Foreign Minister Penny Wong, former Prime Minister Tony Abbott, Shadow Foreign Minister Simon Birmingham, members of Parliament, distinguished members of the Diplomatic Corps, distinguished guests, the families and friends. 17th of July 2014, a date etched in our national memory, when a commercial aeroplane on a routine flight from Amsterdam to Kuala Lumpur and for some on to Melbourne was shot down by a surface-to-air missile, the shot coming from within Russian-held eastern Ukraine. 283 passengers and 15 crew were aboard Malaysian airline MH17. None survived. 196 Dutch citizens, 43 Malaysian, 38 Australian citizens and residents, and others from nations around the world, grieving nations. And the world was shocked, outraged. 10 years on, the families and friends have borne their loss with decency, their grief with dignity. The passing of time may dull the pain, but it will never erase the memory of their loved ones, who, by a cruel twist of fate, were the victims of an atrocity. In a world where millions and millions of people, as a matter of course, put their faith in the safety and security of civil aviation, each and every moment of each and every day. I will never forget the phone call in the early hours of the Friday morning, advising me of an incomprehensible situation that was unfolding. I'll never forget the early phone calls with the family representatives whose grief was inconsolable. Our government's solemn commitment that we would do everything possible to bring them home. Attending a United Nations Security Council meeting in New York, where Australia and the Netherlands and Malaysia achieved what I still believe to be unprecedented, a unanimous resolution within 4 days to give international backing to our response. Without any diplomatic presence in Ukraine, I'll never forget how we deployed over 500 Australian personnel to a temporary embassy that became a nerve centre for our operations, which became an increasingly complex and dangerous mission. Having to convince President Poroshenko and various Ukrainian political parties that we had to recall the Ukrainian parliament that was on summer break in order to pass a resolution to enable us to enter the crash site, and to their everlasting credit, over 500 members returned to parliament. Attending memorial services at Eindhoven Air Base when Australian and Dutch military planes brought our people one step closer to home, confronting President Putin and demanding that Russia take some accountability for this and that they cooperate with the investigation rather than obfuscation and evasion. And I'll never forget the painstaking efforts of the joint investigation team of Australia, the Netherlands, Malaysia and Belgium as we fought for truth and justice and accountability. In fact, Australia and the Netherlands formed a very close bond at that time, working in tandem from the outset. And we even signed a treaty to enable Australian personnel to be in the Netherlands to help with the legal response to the downing of MH17. This is an order of merit that was awarded to me by the Dutch government. I accepted it at the time and I wear it today in tribute to those who lost their lives, to the families and friends who deserve answers and justice, and on behalf of the Australians, from our military, police, diplomatic, consular, legal personnel who were involved in our response, and on behalf of those who continue the fight to this day for truth and justice and accountability. And it is shocking to think that on that day, 10 years ago, Australia found itself at the fulcrum of the Russian-Ukraine conflict that continues to this day with such shocking consequences. So today, we remember those we lost, and our thoughts are with those who loved and were loved by them.
Thank you, Ms. Bishop, for your reflections, and I know many people here today are grateful for your strong leadership at that time. Also making a strong contribution were the more than 500 members of the Australian Federal Police who formed part of the response and investigation to the downing. I'd now like to welcome AFP Commissioner Rhys Kershaw, APM, to make an address.
Good morning. Thank you, Julie Bishop, for those heartfelt words. Distinguished guests, time can provide the embrace we need when trying to survive tragedy. Time can give us answers and help dull the pain of loss. But just as time can heal our scars, a scent, a sound, or a photo can often take us to the time when we first heard about our new cruel reality. For the grieving, this can be an unbearable burden. But we must remember that time is also a marker when we stop to remember. We embrace it because we never want to wish time away. Today, time has reached 10 years since MH17 was shot down. We must acknowledge what today means for families, for loved ones, for Australians, and for the AFP. We take time today for the 298 lives stolen, including those 38 who called Australia home. For the grieving families, we mourn with you about what should have been. When tragedy occurs, we hold on to memories to sustain us and turn to those whose job it is to pursue justice. Initially, the AFP deployed to Donetsk to help secure an horrific crime scene that was an active conflict zone. The crime scene was 50 square kilometres and a juxtaposition, fields of smiling, 6 foot tall sunflowers surrounded by what occurs after such evil. For those on the ground, strength was drawn from the blue patch on their shoulders, the insignia of the AFP. Our mission was clear: do everything possible to return loved ones, find the truth, seek justice, and hold those responsible to account. While we are the protector for Australians, the AFP's mission was to also provide humanity for all who lost. Assistant Commissioner Hilda Sirik was a bomb technician and a then detective sergeant when she deployed to the Ukraine. Hilda was first to identify bow-type shaped fragments had damaged the plane, which pointed to a BUK missile. Hilda was just one of the 500 plus members who have been part of this unprecedented operation. Our world-class forensic experts, led by Dr. Simon Walsh, became a guardian for those lost. Our dedicated family liaison officers remain our guardian for those who have lost. And long after the initial disaster, our members harnessed their skills to help secure evidence critical for the criminal case against those responsible. These members are humble, but they represent the best of Australia and the best of the AFP. I thank the officials who worked tirelessly to get our members to the crash site and supported us through the investigation. I pay tribute to our shared mission with international partners, so critical to this case. I acknowledge those who still pursue all avenues to hold Russia to account. To those whose lives have forever changed, it's understandable if you wish that our paths never crossed in such circumstance. But we are honoured to have served you when you needed us. Time will never weaken our resolve. Time has not diminished our bond to those who never made it home. And time has only strengthened our bond to those who mourn. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner, for those heartfelt words and the contribution of those members. Today is a time to remember the lives of the loved ones we lost. I now wish to invite our next of kin representative for today's service, Malcolm Garrett, to read his poem, Sunflowers in Ukraine, as we reflect on and honour the lives of those victims killed so far away from their home and their loved ones.
Sunflowers in Ukraine. Her hug is warm upon my breast, his vital palm upon my palm. How could unfeeling fate conspire to bring them to such senseless harm? No cause can justify such pain. No righteous stance, no grander plan absolves the crimes of callous men, man's inhumanity to man. Oh, may the sunflowers in Ukraine turn callous hearts so they can see that love alone has moral force and live in peace and harmony. But as for us who mourn them now, if we see yellow sunflowers grow, our hearts will miss a beat and say it's time for us to let them go, though every fibre of our soul would wish and wish it were not so.
Thank you, Malcolm. Thank you for being with us here today and for your moving recital. I'm sure I speak on behalf of everyone here to say we can't fathom how difficult the past 10 years have been for you and all the families and loved ones and friends of the victims. Our thoughts are with you today, as always. I now wish to invite AFP Detective Superintendent Yvonne Crozier to read the names of the victims as the victims and loved ones place a flower in the wreath. I invite the families to come forward and I invite you all to join in this moment of reflection. For other guests who wish to place a flower in the wreath, there'll be an opportunity for you to do so after this service during the morning tea.
Itamar Avnon. Wayne Baker. Teresa Baker. Emma Bell. Michael Clancy. Carol Clancy. Francesca Davison. Liam Davison. Lillian Durden. Fatima Dzinski. Marco Gripling. Jill Gard. Roger Gard. Howard Horder and Susan Horder. Gabrielle Lorchette, Mona Lee, Wai Keong Gary Lee, Adele Mahardy, Emil Mahler, Otis Maslin, Mo Maslin, and Evie Maslin. Nicole Norris, Mary Menke, Gerardus Menke, Daphne Naveen, Jack O'Brien, Victor Oreshkin, Albert Risk and Marie Risk, Ian Ryder and Yvonne Ryder, Helena Sidlick, Teo, Sister Philomene Tyrannan, Johannes van den Hend. Shaleza Dua. Margot van den Hend. Manix van den Hend. And Piers van den Hend.
Thank you, Detective Superintendent, and thank you, of course, to the families and loved ones. And again, our condolences. We can't imagine your grief. Our host, the Minister for Foreign Affairs, Senator the Honourable Penny Wong, would now like to invite you all to have some morning tea with us in the back of the room. It's a time for you to reflect, perhaps reconnect with some of those who share your story. During the morning, so we also do invite anyone who'd like to place a flower in the wreath to do so, to pause, reflect, remember. There's also a commemorative book on that side of the room for anyone wanting to write messages or to put their reflections there. At around 11:40, the wreath will be carried to the MH17 Memorial Park in the Rose Garden. That's going to be a private wreath-laying ceremony to allow the families to have a private moment of reflection. So we'll ask that only those who've been invited to that ceremony follow the wreath from the Great Hall. So I now welcome you to the back of the room for morning tea. Thank you.